Ian is from eftec. If we're taking sides today, I guess Ian's on the environmental economist side, but we're not taking sides. So here's someone who's interested in values and realizing the broader social values of our land and natural resources. Ian.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Ian, and thank you for the invite to speak today. I'm an environmental economist, and I'll talk more about a lot of the concepts that Ian's already introduced, and hopefully that'll give you a good understanding of what an environmental economist is and how they think. If it doesn't, another way of thinking about it is that I'm a bird watcher who did an economics degree. So I'll talk just quickly about eftec. You probably haven't heard of us before, some of you. So we're environmental economists solely. That's our specialism. In existence for 21 years. Ian mentioned Professor David Pearce. So eftec was a university startup from postgraduate students of David Pearce 20 years ago. And so we divide up what we do into thinking about values. We do primary valuation work using the techniques Ian mentioned, but then also applying those in economic appraisal and in reviewing, designing policies. And we also do training work. And environmental economics on its own, I don't really think it's that interesting. What makes it interesting is when you work with experts in the environmental issues you're dealing with. So I'm fortunate to manage teams with marine specialists, forestry specialists, not enough with land valuers, but maybe we can change that. And actually combining environmental economics with that technical information is what makes it interesting. So just what I'll cover a bit is why do we need sort of economic value evidence? I'll talk a bit more about ecosystem services and then valuation methods, and then how they start to be captured with some of the techniques Ian referred to. So to frame what I call economics, because this might be where some of the difference lies, is we're not talking about the cheapest way. We're looking at the net benefit to society, covering that range of goods that Ian referred to, and not interested in commercial gain on its own. It's a subset of what we look at, but economics prices are a proxy for social welfare, for people's well-being overall. So when we start to think about welfare, we're talking about utility and net changes in those. And so not only money income, but this concept of total economic value is very important. And Ian mentioned the distinctions of market, non-market, internal, external. So we want to understand those values. We're sort of thinking about people's demand for the environment, whether or not they have a market in which to express that demand. And you can, if you're mathematical, you can think about a demand function that we're trying to specify. Then there are ways we demonstrate that value. So in economic appraisals, cost-benefit analysis, impact assessments of changes in policy, you want to use some of those values to illustrate those. And we now also have methods of accounting coming forward, and indeed corporate accounting, looking at land ownership in the UK, how you might construct an environmental account is a challenge eftec is currently working on. And then you get instruments then, if once you know that value, say, how can I reflect that? And the incentives people face and economic instruments play a role in that. So we've already been introduced to the concepts of ecosystem services and this divide, so I'll skip over that. And then you get these very complicated diagrams. So don't look at all the detail of the flows, but what's interesting here firstly is the structure of logic in the row across the top. So we want to understand how the environment works, the processes, you need the scientists to tell you about these physical and chemical processes and so on. And you get finally system services. But if you look at the colors of those boxes in the two columns on the left, there's quite a variety of supporting, regulating, provisioning services, cultural services. And Ian made the point that the things that are captured in markets aren't necessarily the majority of the things in those two boxes and those different colors. So there's quite a range of stuff we're trying to cover there. They provide goods to people. We know something about the values of those goods. And we may have market prices. We may need to look at non-monetized values if we can't capture things in monetary terms. That overall, those two columns on the right are the contribution to well-being. So we're trying to use economics to have a consistent way of measuring those changes using a single unit, money. It doesn't always work. We recognize there are gaps in it. But if you can get everything down to money, it helps you make trade-offs. So you've got a judgment to make. Do you monetize everything and then it helps you make trade-offs, or do you put some more weight on the things you haven't got a monetary value for, but they're important to you? And we should always bear that balance in mind. Economists aren't necessarily the best person to make that decision. In fact, that's a decision usually made by politicians and other decision makers. And it's an economist's job to make that option clear, that you don't have to rely on monetary values for your decision, but that's what economists are trained to give you. So let's think about how this sort of thing applies. So how do we think about, as an environmental economist, the costs and benefits of coastal realignment? So this is taking a bit of land that's terrestrial, protected from the sea, and changing that and making it part of the intertidal zone. So then who are the costs and benefits? And then you have to think about who these are for too. So there's an opportunity cost of the agricultural land or the other land use that's lost. And that's probably the primary concern to land valuers. And there might be some property lost. And then there's also the issue of, well, what were you doing to maintain that land? Capital expenditure on the flood protections, the operating costs of maintaining those, there could be a cost or a saving to those things. So that's all part of the sort of cost equation. But then you potentially get a whole range of benefits, most of which are outside markets. So intertidal land can support commercial fisheries. It can sequester carbon. It can make delivering flood protection cheaper. And that could be double counted with changes in the capital and operational expenditure on the other side. You have to be careful of that, as Ian said. Intertidal land can absorb nutrients. We talked about the nitrate cycle, so phosphate and nitrates. The land also might support a high level of biodiversity, might have attraction as a recreational resource and potentially for tourism, depending on the area where it is. It can improve air quality and even play a role in regeneration. But all those things, the majority of them lie outside markets. So we get a huge range of potential benefits, but real challenges in trying to capture them. Compared to that opportunity cost is the primary thing that lies in markets. So if we want to try and measure all that wide range of benefits, we need to have a structure, a bit of a process for doing so. So I would say, firstly, you just want to understand what the changes are, qualitative assessment, and decide how much effort you want to put into applying environmental economics. If you do want to progress with it, you need good technical information from specialists, from scientists I talked about. So that's the kind of quantitative assessment. And only when you've really done those things adequately can you think about doing monetary analysis of both the non-market and market goods using environmental economics. And we use the ecosystem services framework to make this discussion easier, because it's a language that works between scientists and environmental economists. It may not work well for everyone in this room, I appreciate that. So if that's something you'll maybe want to learn from today, is there a better shared language that we have that will make dialogue easier? So we have technical knowledge on ecosystem services, inputs to firstly your qualitative and then your quantitative analysis, and then you can move on to applying the different valuation methods that Ian mentioned, and hopefully you get input to decision making from it. And I'll talk a bit more about those methods. So in doing this, we need to be very careful to say, what's the good? How much is it changing? Because in valuing things, we're valuing change. We're not valuing the total worth of the environment. How does a particular change in the environment affect people? That's what we can value. And we're very interested in whose values those are, because that matters. And then when you decide what you're trying to look at, you can choose appropriate valuation methods. So I'll try and just go in a bit more detail of these things. So we've got this distinction between market and non-market goods, and we've got a big challenge to value the non-market goods. So we're trying to get this price as a proxy for changes in well-being, and we might have a market price for some things. We might have a price tag on those market goods, and they might be associated with some of the non-market goods. So for water, we can see how people behave in their purchases of bottled water or using water filters. That shows some demand for the quality of water they receive. And we can use that to reflect on whether water bills are structured in the right way. And other things have associations, so health and safety, with how people make defensive expenditures to protect their well-being. So those, when those kind of proxies exist, we can see how behavior in an existing market relates to the provision of a non-market good, and from that infer the value of the non-market good. But we have to specify the quantities of those change. And so that's where you need, as I said, emphasizing this technical information about what's changing before you can apply environmental economics from one quantity to another. And the key question is, how much does the customer's well-being change? Yeah, I'll just stay on that for a second. So one of the real difficulties of trying to use the stated preference methods, where you don't have a market at all and you go and ask people what's your value of these things, is you need a way of quantifying these changes that can be both understood by the people they're affecting and actually make sense to what would actually happen in the real world. And I'll try and give you an example from the marine environment. This applies equally, though, to changes on land. So when the UK passed the Marine Act, policymakers wanted to know how much do people value marine protection. And so a question was asked to people, you know, how much are you willing to pay for a network of marine protected areas that would halt biodiversity loss? And this, you know, study is done carefully so that that question is framed to be one that we know the majority of respondents will understand. So they understand the concept of nature reserves. They can be made in the sea as well as on land, and that's going to protect biodiversity and halt declines. That made sense to the respondents, so the survey can be valid in that sense. But then when you go to the marine scientists and you say, okay, we're going to design marine nature reserves and it's going to halt biodiversity loss, and they say, well, how do we know? We can designate marine nature reserves, but they might not halt biodiversity loss. So you might design a question that people understand, but actually it doesn't make sense in what you can manage in the world. And so having a way of connecting those things is a real challenge, and that's why using those valuation techniques is quite expensive, because you have to put a lot of effort into designing the question so that people will understand it and give you a valid response, but that response will also relate to something that will happen in the real world. So generating evidence like that can be quite expensive, which maybe is why a lot of it's not done that frequently, or a lot of it's done in academic research. It takes time and expertise and money. But we do start to have a set of valuation evidence, and it's building up over time. So how can we make better use of it? And that comes to what's often called benefits transfer, but I would refer to it as value transfer, because the values can be positive or negative, so it's not just benefits. So we have quite a lot of valuation evidence of different things, and we can transfer them to new decision-making contexts to understand the values we're trying to get insights to. Now, one thing to say is the balance of evidence isn't necessarily right. So the things we do have values for, a bias towards maybe certain decision-making contexts we've paid more attention to. Something like the regulated water industry has an awful lot of analysis, but that isn't necessarily the most important set of changes, it's just where the analysis has been done. It might also be the things that we had an opportunity to measure, and so there's a bias towards valuing those things. There's also in the past been a bias towards measuring the unit values people, individuals hold, rather than measuring the number of individuals that value affects. And that's something we've learned from experience. So a lot of academic methods have gone down the route of saying, you know, so an individual's recreational value for a visit to a woodland, is that £5 or £10? I mean, well, so that's quite an interesting question, and what drives that value is important. But what's much more important is not, you know, £5 or £10, so, you know, doubling, but is it that value applying to 10,000 people or 50,000 people? So that's a five order of magnitude. Or when you get to non-use, non-market benefits, who values those whales in Antarctica? Is it a million people who are sort of deep conservationists, or is it 100 million people or a billion people? So that's an order of magnitude of 1,000. That's much more important than whether it's 5 or 10. And actually not enough attention's been paid to the number of people who hold the values compared to what their individual value is. But that's starting to be corrected, partly through the ecosystem services concept allowing us to understand it, and partly through having computer modeling GIS systems that let you look at things spatially in more detail. And it's also a key assumption in when you transfer values. So we have, you know, a set of valuation information, and in some cases we can transfer that to new locations. So for example, we have a recreational value in one part of the country, Thetford Forest. I'm not sure my red circle is quite hitting Thetford Forest, but it's close enough. And you transfer it over to another location. So Delamere Forest in the northwest, you know, then what are the similarities and differences between these locations, and is it valid to take a value from Thetford and move it to Delamere Forest? And there's a whole range of criteria we go through to say how accurate is that transfer, do you adjust it for different reasons, and you look at, you know, exactly what's being provided, the type of goods, so is the forest the same, the type of changes, the recreational provision being improved in the same way, who holds those values, is it just the users or is it people who might live locally and like the fact that their local forests are healthy? And so on. And so, but we have methods now and a sort of a standardized process for doing this in value transfer guidelines. And there will be a certain error in all these values, and we just have to be honest and open about that. And if the error is too high, the value, the information isn't usable in decision making. Okay, and so then, as already mentioned, there's various instruments for trying then to capture these values. So we say a particular woodland is particularly valuable, as was reflected on with the arguments about the so-called privatization of woodlands, and the reaction to that was an indication of people holding non-market values for those woodlands. So that was then looked at in more detail, and you want a mechanism for trying to capture those things, for rewarding those people who are providing the total economic value, not just the things that are captured in markets. Told not to linger too much on biodiversity offsets, that's fine, but I want to say just two things. So firstly, there's a contradiction. Sometimes people say, I'm not in favor of biodiversity offsets, I want to see the mitigation hierarchy used, which I hope is something people are familiar with from planning processes. But actually, offsets are the fourth step of the mitigation hierarchy. They are part of that process. So the first three steps are much more important in our current system, and it's essential that they're the first three steps and we don't shortcut to offsets, but they are part of an overall hierarchy to avoid damage. And they should be seen together like that. And then in the things that Ian talked about with covenants and property rights, there are some very interesting legal and financial implications of the objective to protect biodiversity in perpetuity. Perpetuity is a very scary concept for people owning and managing land. But it's sort of an essential objective for conservationists and the desire to protect biodiversity. So that at the moment is a sort of division in the view. And then, so what's a good compromise? Is it an agri-environment scheme that gives a 10-year set of payments to a landowner, or a biodiversity offset that's purchased for 25 years? In land market terms, 25 years might be quite a long time. In biodiversity terms, it's not. So we've got a problem of bringing those things together. But at least we appreciate those differences better than we did a few years ago. And also I'm gonna back up what Ian said about payments for ecosystem services, and I think Petrina's gonna talk more about this. So that's into a beneficiary pays approach on ecosystem services. And being voluntary, you have to have what, as an economist, I would call conditions of exchange. The transaction costs have gotta be low enough to be worthwhile bringing people together. And so transaction costs, you can look at things like administration that have obviously financial costs, but then another big transaction costs is trust in the system. And you don't want to take too big a risk in something. That's a normal way of people approaching a market. If the risk is too high, even though if they get what they think they might get, it would be beneficial to them. If the risk is too high, they won't. So one of the ways we reduce risk, Ian referred to monitoring, verification, and so the sort of, I think the land market system has a really important role to play in that. If people can trust an outcome, then they're much more likely to enter into an exchange for it, and so you're more likely to get these kind of agreements happening. Okay, and so then contrasting that with agri-environment agreements, there's this sort of traditional opportunity cost-based approach. And there are some interesting variants on that coming forward now. So proposals that you might vary payments from being a sort of quite flat rates across the country. They are differentiated, you know, by upland, lowland, arable, grass and systems, but really very little variation across the whole of England and indeed the UK, although the devolved administrations now have their systems. There's really very little variation across the country in what's paid. But there might be ways of starting to introduce those variations that mean we get a lot more back for our agri-environment payments. So one is a idea is a kind of agglomeration premium that, you know, an individual farmer or landowner doing a certain set of actions might have a certain value for biodiversity, for landscape. But if they do it in a coordinated way with their neighbours, you create a bigger block of land which has those values, and that area has a value that's greater than some of its parts because there's a, those things complement each other. Equally, you might say you want more regional variations in the way payments are made to reflect different values in different locations. And an example of that would be, if you think about water supplies, there are certain parts of catchments in the UK that have very high rainfall, that are intensively farmed and have a lot of people living downstream. Those are the ones where managing the land to protect water resources is going to have the highest value. We don't vary our payments to reflect that really anywhere in the UK from the agri-environment schemes. There are then water companies step in to supplement the schemes, but then that becomes complicated because you've got sort of different payment systems working on top of each other on the land. And then a final thing in design of these payments is that it's basically the government paying on behalf of taxpayers, and they're trying to guess what the value would be to, or the cost would be to the provider, and they want to pay them that much, and it's got to be less than the value society will get from that payment. So the government is effectively trying to guess what the cost is to the landowner of providing those services. And I mean, you can go to, which environmental economists do, they go to Nick's Farm Handbook and say, what's the cost of reducing a certain activity and intensity? That's what we're going to pay the farmer. That's not particularly sophisticated, but then we don't have the information about what it's actually going to cost the land manager to make that change. Well, a way of getting them to tell you that cost is to hold an auction, because then they have to tell you what they want to be paid to do something, and then they reveal actually how much it's really going to cost them. So the suggestion is, and a few trials have supported this, that by auctioning, you might get a lot more information about what it will cost people to do things, and you'll be able to target your payments much more efficiently. And as I said, all these mechanisms require monitoring in order to build trust and also then provide information between the parties involved. It's a very important aspect of all these things. And I also think they require monitoring because we're talking about things we don't fully understand how they're going to work. And if we don't monitor them and learn, we're not going to improve them. And we're going to be just as clueless in 10 years' time, which would be a shame. So thank you. I hope that helps our future discussions, and I'm looking forward to the reactions to what's said.